darles a todos ustedes la bienvenida a nuestra ciudad, a Pueblo de Zaragoza, ciudad que cuenta, como ustedes seguramente ya lo han podido apreciar, un rico patrimonio cultural, particularmente su centro histórico que está inscrito en la lista del Patrimonio Mundial de la Humanidad. Bienvenidos también a lo que va a ser la sede de prácticamente la mayor parte de las actividades programadas por este congreso, en lo que es el edificio Carolino, inmueble construido por los jesuitas en el siglo XVII y que desde ese momento hasta la fecha es un espacio a través del cual se siguen generando para la sociedad poblana, para el país y también abiertos al mundo, ideas, innovaciones, transmisión de saberes. Esta continuidad es la que queremos mantener en nuestra zona de monumentos. Quisiera en esta oportunidad agradecer a la Sociedad de Economía Ecológica, al doctor Cavalcanti en particular, al doctor David Barkin, el que nos hayan invitado a la Universidad Autónoma de Puebla, a la Benemérita Universidad Autónoma de Puebla, a compartir esta aventura de organizar este 15 Congreso. Para nosotros ha representado un reto y sin embargo el apoyo decidido del equipo de la Universidad Autónoma Metropolitana, encabezado por el maestro Carlos Hernández, por la licenciada María Luisa Serrano, nos ha permitido acompañarlos y organizar los espacios y la logística necesaria para lo que esperamos sea un gran evento. Les agradezco realmente, doctor Barkin, doctor Cavalcanti, la confianza que han depositado en nuestra institución. También agradezco al doctor Salvador Pérez, quien tramposamente me ha conferido el honor de dirigirme a ustedes en este evento inaugural. Y digo tramposamente porque en realidad él, como director de la Facultad de Economía, a él le correspondía realmente hacer los honores en esta inauguración. Pero bueno, aceptamos el reto. Gracias, doctor. Sin lugar a dudas, el evento es de una extrema relevancia. Me parece que de manera puntual, tanto el doctor Barkin como el doctor Cavalcanti han puesto en esta, con estas palabras iniciales, los temas que están o que van a estar en el centro de la reflexión, del debate que va a guiar el desarrollo de este evento. La crisis del modelo de desarrollo es evidente, la forma en que este modelo ha ignorado justamente la diversidad cultural, los aportes que nuestros pueblos originarios pueden y han hecho durante siglos a la preservación del medio ambiente, no pueden ser ignorados más. Me parece que la gran pregunta es si en el contexto de esta crisis, en el contexto de lo que está ocurriendo dentro de los límites del propio modelo impuesto por el neoliberalismo, podemos efectivamente construir una alternativa distinta de desarrollo, que coloque efectivamente o replantee efectivamente la relación entre sociedad y naturaleza, considerando precisamente la diversidad cultural de la cual provenimos, considerando precisamente los límites que los diversos entornos ecológicos del mundo tienen para proveer a sociedades y al mundo posibilidades reales de desarrollo. En este debate, y creo que ese es lo que más nos motivó para efectivamente aceptar este reto de acompañarlos en este proceso, estamos convencidos de que las universidades y particularmente las instituciones de educación superior de carácter público de nuestro país tienen un enorme compromiso en este proceso, no solamente en términos de investigación, sino también en términos de construir las vías, las formas, las metodologías que nos permitan una comunicación eficaz entre la academia y estas comunidades que forman parte de nuestra diversidad cultural. Agradeciendo pues nuevamente esta distinción, y si me lo permiten, solicitarles que se pongan de pie a efecto de hacer la declaratoria formal de inauguración. Siendo las 10 horas con 20 minutos de este día 10 de septiembre de 2018, me permito formalmente declarar inaugurados los trabajos de este 15 Congreso de la Sociedad Internacional de Economía Ecológica, esperando que el desarrollo de sus trabajos sean en beneficio de nuestras instituciones y de las sociedades a las cuales representamos. Muchas gracias, felicidades.
Agradecemos 10, 11 y 12 de septiembre de 2018 en esta ciudad de Puebla, México. Convocados por la Universidad Autónoma Metropolitana, Unidad Xochimilco, por la Benemérita Universidad Autónoma de Puebla, en colaboración con la Sociedad Mesoamericana y del Caribe de Economía Ecológica. En esta ceremonia inaugural nos acompañan el presidente de la Sociedad Internacional de Economía Ecológica, doctor Clovis Cavalcanti. Bienvenido. Damos la bienvenida de igual manera al coordinador general del 15º Congreso de la Sociedad Internacional de Economía Ecológica, profesor distinguido de la Universidad Autónoma Metropolitana, doctor David Barkin Rapaport. De igual forma, damos la bienvenida al director del Instituto de Ciencias Sociales y Humanidades, doctor Alfonso Vélez Pliego, de la Benemérita Universidad Autónoma de Puebla, doctor Francisco Vélez Pliego. El director de la Facultad de Economía de la Benemérita Universidad Autónoma de Puebla, doctor Salvador Pérez Mendoza. Damos la bienvenida al director de la División de Ciencias Sociales y Humanidades de la Universidad Autónoma Metropolitana, maestro Carlos Alfonso Hernández Gómez. De igual manera, damos la bienvenida a conferencistas, académicos, investigadores, estudiantes e interesados en los temas que se abordarán en este evento, provenientes tanto de México como de otros países, deseando que tengan una muy fructífera y placentera estancia en esta ciudad. Un aplauso para todos ustedes. En primer término, Damos la palabra al coordinador general del 15º Congreso de la Sociedad Internacional de Economía Ecológica para que nos explique los motivos por los que se realiza este evento, el doctor David Barkin Rapaport.
It's extraordinary to be here. Now, some of us wondered whether we'd ever get here today. The fact that this meeting is being held in Mexico is particularly striking at this moment. Many of you know that we had an election on July 1st, and we have, as many of us think, we're going through what we hope will be a relatively peaceful process of regime change. This is very, very significant, not only for those of us who are Mexican, not only for all of the people who are in Mexico, but we think it will, we hope that it will be very important for all of Latin America. This event couldn't have happened without the extraordinary and generous collaboration of the two universities that are co-sponsoring this event, the Benemérita Universidad Autónoma de Puebla and the Universidad Autónoma Metropolitana in Mexico City. But because, of course, behind this, these two institutions a team of people that have worked way above and beyond whatever we might have expected and hoped for. And it's because of that team that we're here today. I would like to ask you for an applause for that team. They're going to be visible, and I'm not going to name them now. But I want to make a few comments about what it means to have this meeting of ecological economics here in Mexico. And the fact that the society, when it accepted the proposal to have the meeting here, understood that this would not be a meeting like most of the other 14 meetings we've had of this conference since the society was founded in 1989. Because during that period of time, most of ecological economics, most ecological economists have dedicated their energy to doing what academics do. And that is writing papers, doing research, publishing, and being very concerned about institutional and career development. But this meeting here in Latin America today, in Mexico today, in certain ways has been organized. There are a number of events which are going to explicitly challenge you as ecological economists practicing aspirantes, aspiring professionals, to ask a different kind of question. How can our research serve society? How can we reorganize our research methods, our academic teaching? How can our work as ecological economists contribute to something more than developing the academia? How can we serve the needs of people, of the people who are fighting against the forces that dominate the world capitalist system? How can we support the hundreds of millions of indigenous people, the hundreds of millions of peasants, and the hundreds of millions of workers who are organizing themselves to try to resist the extraordinary problems of the degradation of the planet and the quality of our life? But it's not only that they're here, that they're working to resist. And that, in my way of thinking, is the important task of why you are here today. Because they are not just resisting. They are not just engaging in conflicts around environmental justice, as many of you are involved. Because most of these people that I have named are in organizations that are trying to build alternatives for themselves and create niches which will make the world, the planet, a better place for all of us to live in. This is a different agenda than the historical agenda of the society, the International Society for Ecological Economics. This is a different agenda than most of the articles that are published in the journal called Ecological Economics. And to do that, we've organized plenary sessions which will not have keynote addresses. And that's been deliberate. We have invited to these plenary sessions actors, protagonists, who are involved in one way or another in this struggle, not to criticize what's going on, but to build something beyond it and better. This meeting of the society, this 15th Congress of Ecological Economics, is not, therefore, an occasion for us to show off how great we are as researchers. But I hope that it is an occasion for us to think about what is our contributions, collectively and individually and institutionally, to build a better world. That is the challenge that we have. And this conference will not be successful unless the people who are in these plenary sessions, unless some of the papers are successful in asking you, in helping you, to think, to move beyond the methodologies that you were trained with in your universities, and to move beyond and change the epistemologies to create new ontologies. This morning's panel will start with that by actually challenging you to think whether your cosmologies are in fact the cosmologies which are relevant for today's world. So on this note, which is a challenging note, I thank you very much for being here. I thank the team for making it possible for us to be here. And I really will appreciate at the end of this conference if you tell us whether we were successful or not. Thank you very much.
Agradecemos el mensaje del Coordinador General del 15º Congreso de la Sociedad Internacional de Economía Ecológica, Dr. David Barkin. A continuación, escucharemos el mensaje que nos dirige el presidente de la Sociedad Internacional de Economía Ecológica, Dr. Clovis Cavalcanti.
Dear friends, with great honor and joy, I ask your permission and the organizers, in the name of their coordinator, my old friend Dave Barkin, to offer you a few words of greeting. First of all, I want to thank you for giving me the enormous privilege of presiding over the International Society for Ecological Economic, ISEE, in 2018-2019. Our great moment during my tenure is exactly now, when we meet in this conference. David and his formidable group of collaborators, whom I came to appreciate very warmly since coming to the UAM George Miluku campus in October 2017 to participate in preparations for our reunion, are creditors of our recognition and tribute for the work they have done. The task was not easy, especially because of the great limitation of resources which had to be overcome in the running of the event. Fortunately, the Autonomous University of Mexico, UAM, and the Benemerita Autonomous University of Puebla, BUAP, provided the minimum support base that the organizing committee needed to carry out its mission. This base was used by the committee with mastery. It thus deserves all our appreciation, mine especially, and applause. Thank you, David. Thank you, Maria Luisa. Thank you, all other members of the committee. And many thanks also to Anne Carter, admirable ISE Executive Secretary, who cloned herself in Boston so that nothing was lacking in our headquarters support for the 2018 meeting. I could not omit many thanks as well to the members of the board of ISE, Bernardo Aguilar, David Bark, myself, Eva Klusinova, Jasper Kenta, Madhavi Venkatesan, Peter May, Richard Howard, Tatiana Kluvankova, and Volker Mauerhofer, who have done what they could for the success of all our ISEE activities. By the way, to pronounce the acronym of our society in English, I prefer the solution adopted in Brazil not to spell, but to express acronyms always as a word. In our case, ISEE would be, in English, IC. I like this coincidence. Seeing, perceiving reality as it is in a holistic fashion is the task of our society, founded by scholars who are against ignoring the ecological dimension of in economic processes. When I decided to stop being a conventional economist in the manner of Paul Samuelson, Robert Solow, George Stigler, and so on, and follow the guidance of Nicola Georgescu Regan, I was convinced of the wisdom of the latter's proposal for introducing thermodynamics in the economic approach by changing the understanding of the field he used to call ordinary economics. I was fortunate to hear Georgescu in Rio when I was 23 and an admirer of neoclassical theory. Some years later, I met Herman Daly, and then my adherence to the entropic vision of the economic process was completed. I consider myself a post-economist. Ecological economics is for me the ecological view of the economy against the economic view of the economy of neoclassical and Keynesian economics. The economic view of nature, in turn, is the perspective of the environmental economist. Early on in my work as an ecological economist, I joined the strong sustainability side and assumed the steady state economy model. Later, being in permanent touch with Joan Martinez Allier since Washington, D.C. in May 1999, I also realized that our commitment is to work with the notion of the incommensurability of values, social environmental conflicts and injustice, different languages of valuation, issues of political ecology, which Dave Barkin has helped me to understand better. In 1964-1965, David and I were roommates in New Haven, studying at Yale, along with a colleague of mine from Rio, Edmar Bacha, who became a prominent Brazilian neoclassical economist. I visited David in 1970 in New York, where he was a professor at the City University of New York. Staying in his Greenwich apartment, he soon let me know that he had become a radical economist. He also warned me to be careful when using his telephone line, because he was being followed by the FBI. And his phone was tapped. To my delight, he told of his approximation of Cuba and friendship with Che Guevara. With this reference, I cannot be a light ecological economist. This is one reason why I would like the ISEE to become a scientific society committed to promoting the art of life, good living, buen vivir, happiness, social equity, studying how to achieve that much with a minimal ecological footprint. I would like thus to propose that we be more militant. May we have the courage to take on values such as those exposed by the papal encyclical Laudato Si, and like those adopted in the philosophy of GN8, Gross National Happiness, introduced in the Kingdom of Bhutan from 1972 on. With a view to this commitment, I have sought an involvement with the encyclical Laudato Si, whose ecological economic credentials seem to be straightforward. In this context, on behalf of ISEIC, and with the agreement of the board, I have approached the Roman Pontiff and the Holy See in order to show how close we are in terms of the proper use of nature for the promotion of human well-being. To this end, I met Pope Francis in Rome on November the 23rd, 2016, together with Stuart Scott, a member of ISEE and a pro bono strategic consultant to the board. My wife, Vera, accompanied us as a photographer. Hence, why I consider the theme of this IC conference, ecological economics and socio-ecological movements, science, policy, and challenges to global processes in a troubled world, very appropriate for what I am proposing now. In this sense, I agree with Dave Barkin's view that a deeper and more radical epistemological and ethical rupture is required of ecological economics with the premises of neoclassical economic rationality. It helps that David Suzuki, with whom I went to Bhutan in January 2013, has said that as top predator, our species remains dependent on clean air, water, and soil, and biodiversity, making our ability to survive catastrophic planetary disruption questionable. This is a perception we catch also from the Global Footprint Network's calculations, leading us to the conclusion that there must be a demarcation of the commitment ecological economists must make to the sustainability of life on the planet. In 2003, in Havana, at the third Latin America and Caribbean Conference of Social Sciences of the Latin America Social Science Council, I heard from Fidel Castro at the closing of the meeting that such reunions would not be feasible in the future if you did not take care of the health of the planetary ecosystem. Something similar I heard from Evo Morales in October 2009 in Cochabamba when the Bolivian president opened the fifth conference of the same Claxo series. Morales said, the rights of the earth come before human rights. The challenges are clear. Our world has moved into an increasingly frightening picture of unsustainability. The collapse of the Genoa Bridge, Italy, last August, indicates this sense of unsustainability. Something can happen suddenly in complex socio-ecological systems totally beyond our imagination. The commitment of ecological economists is to sustainable bridges, sustainable health, sustainable human well-being, broad equity, and the prudent use of life support systems. It is, as the title of a book by our IC colleague, Brian Scheck, a former student of Herman Daly, who says, our situation is like that of shoveling fuel for a runaway train. This will end badly one day as the ongoing process is unsustainable. I hope that and wish that we can leave Puebla at the end of this conference assured of our historical responsibilities as ecological economists, rejecting an image that we are a branch of economics. No, our field of work is that of a revolutionary, post-normal, dialectical science committed to the supreme value of life with equality, efficiency, and sustainability. Thank you all for coming to this land of so much telluric strength, the cradle of corn and vanilla, a land of great indigenous heroes of Frida Kahlo, Diego Rivera, and so many artists. A land chosen by the Virgin Mary to appear in Guadalupe, no brown-skinned and with mestizo traits to the Indian Juan Diego Cuauhtlatoacin in 1531, speaking with him in his native language, Nahuatl. May I repeat the words of my speech at the opening of the 12th IC meeting in Rio in June 2012. Our affection for humanity should lead us to think about improving the human condition. As David has just underlined, this is the task I conceive of ecological economics following the diagnosis of Alfred North Whitehead, that we are here first to live, second to live well, and thirdly to live better. We are not here to own more and more gadgets, some plainly stupid. We do not want to see our world collapsing like that fateful bridge in Genoa. We love life. We want to preserve nature for our descendants. This takes us to affection at the base of sustainability and of IC. In 2012, Herman Daly sent me an instructive text of a lecture that Wendell Berry, a sensitive American poet, essayist, novelist, and farmer, I also own an organic farm, gave in April that year at National Endowment for Humanity in Washington, D.C. In it, he says that it is in affection that we find the possibility of a neighborly, kind, and conserving economy. The concept of sustainability requires, according to Berry, that the fertility cycle of birth, growth, maturity, death, and decay should turn continually in place so that nothing is wasted. Barry explains that for this to happen in the stewardship of humans, there must be a cultural cycle in harmony with the fertility cycle. The cultural cycle would then be what is meant by sustainability. Barry concludes, the fertility cycle turns by the law of nature. The cultural cycle turns on affection. I like to thank here the work of all the presidents of IC who have been at this helm before me, giving their best to build an organization that promotes our ideal of sustainability, justice, and efficiency. Thanks, Bob Costanza, Dick Norgard, John Proops, Charles Perrin, Joan Martinez Allier, who is here, Peter May, who is here as well, John Gaudi, Bina Agarwal, Marina Fischer-Kowalski, and Sabine O'Hara. I wish the president-elect, Josh Farley, who is sitting at the end of the room, my friend, since we met at Herman Daly's house 2 days before 9/11, and almost a neighbor in Olinda, my hometown, where his father-in-law lives, a fruitful job towards more activism and more activities that leave smaller ecological footprints as strong features of IC. This way, let us thus make IC a human enterprise revolving around affection. Have a very good conference. Thank you. Gracias.
We are an NGO that has worked for 28 years to try and create a healthy environment for those members of the environment that can't speak for themselves as well as for all of us. I'm going to take a practice that we use in Canada, and I'm going to start by acknowledging that we are on the traditional territories of the Nahua, the Totonac, the Mixtec, the Popolocos, and the Otomi people. Context is very important when doing this work. I'd also like to take a moment to thank Dr. Barkin for asking this session to be organized, and to thank Michelle Molnar, the ecological economist from the David Suzuki Foundation, for pulling it together. We have an incredible group of speakers, indigenous people from Canada, Africa, and Mexico. I will introduce each of them individually. They will speak for about 15 minutes, and at the end, we hope to leave time for all of you to ask questions and create a bit of a conversation. Around the indigenous view of economics and ecology, but also around how to work with those communities and with those people when you're being a researcher or being an academic. There are some very important lessons that I hope you will all take from that today. We'll begin with Albert Chan Zul. Albert is based here in Mexico and belongs to the Mayan village in Sanachat in the Mexican part of the Yucatan Peninsula. He's been actively engaged in the Interdisciplinary Center for Alternative Research and Development. The Mayan is Uyik Luum. The center hosts a group of indigenous youth who combine science with traditional knowledge to revalue and rescue the rich cultural and agricultural biodiversity in their Mayan ancestors. Albert is a biologist with a master's degree in management and conservation of tropical forest and biodiversity from KT in Costa Rica. He has been a counselor of the Regional Indigenous and Popular Council of Ixtpuil, a social organization that works in Campeche, Mexico. From there, he's directed training activities for indigenous communities and design, management, and implementation of community management projects, ecological restoration, and ecotourism. He's also a member of the ICCA, the Indigenous Conserved Community Areas Consortium. Albert.
Bueno, buenos días. Efectivamente, mi nombre es Albert. Soy de una comunidad maya que se llama Sanajcat, aquí en la península de Yucatán. Y vengo en esta ocasión en la representación del consorcio ICA. Primero me gustaría agradecer a los organizadores de este evento, en especial al doctor David, que nos invitó a participar. Como les decía, vengo en representación de una organización. Yo también soy de una organización local en mi comunidad. Pero me gustaría hablarles de esto que les acaban de mencionar, del consorcio ICA. Más que del consorcio, me gustaría hablar del objetivo, de lo que queremos hacer a través de este consorcio que es global. En español le decimos TICA, que son como una abreviación para referirnos a los territorios y áreas conservados por los pueblos indígenas y las comunidades locales. Para nosotros, estos territorios son el eje central, el núcleo, pues, del territorio de nosotros como pueblos indígenas. ¿Pero qué son los TICA? Los TICA están en una gran diversidad en todo el mundo. Y para empezar a aclarar que no se pretende crear un nuevo término o una nueva categoría, solamente es una forma de referirnos a algo que existe en los territorios y que son nombrados de diferentes maneras, que pueden ser territorios de vida, que pueden ser los mismos ejidos como los conocemos nosotros en México. ¿Pero qué son? Básicamente, tiene tres características, que no son características que nosotros inventamos, sino que son una descripción de lo que existe en el territorio, de lo que existe en la realidad. Y básicamente es la existencia de una comunidad y un territorio, la relación fuerte que existe entre esta comunidad y este territorio, y algo muy importante son las estructuras que permiten tomar decisiones dentro de ese territorio. Estructuras para tomar decisiones, pero también estructuras, instituciones que permiten el cumplimiento de estos, de estos territorios. Ahora entiendo por qué estoy todo enredado con esto. Lo estoy escuchando en inglés. esa sería la segunda, las instituciones de gobernanza. Es muy claro, hay que aclarar también que cuando hablamos de instituciones de gobernanza o de gobernanza, aunque para nosotros son términos nuevos, como el término de gobernanza, en realidad los aceptamos para referirnos a esas instituciones que de por sí ya existen, que toman decisiones, que para nosotros en los ejidos, por ejemplo, son las asambleas ejidales. Esa sería como la segunda característica. Y la tercera es que la existencia de esta comunidad y ese territorio y la existencia de esas instituciones que toman decisiones permiten que haya conservación. Y lo más importante es que esta conservación no necesariamente es un objetivo, sino un resultado. Es decir, el manejo que se hace, el uso que se hace de los recursos, permite que haya una conservación, permite que haya un proceso de restauración, de recuperación y de uso sostenible. Esto es lo que existe en la realidad. Ahora, como ustedes, todos ustedes saben, y como ya se ha mencionado aquí, estos territorios están todo el tiempo en peligro. ¿Cuáles son los peligros a los que nos enfrentamos o a los que se enfrentan? Los peligros pueden ser básicamente de dos tipos. Los peligros externos, que ahora están los principales, podríamos decir, que es la expropiación, este acaparamiento de las tierras, esta serie de proyectos y de megaproyectos que empiezan a afectar nuestros territorios y amenazas internas también a nuestros territorios. Y los principales serían la pérdida del conocimiento local, la erosión del conocimiento local y la pérdida de esas instituciones de gobernanza. Pero es muy importante aclarar también que estas amenazas internas muchas veces son producto de esas amenazas externas. La educación formal que contrasta con nuestra cultura, la la misma declaración de reservas naturales sobre nuestros territorios, que paradójicamente imponen reservas, pero al mismo tiempo imponen megaproyectos. ¿Y qué hacemos para responder a estas amenazas? Hacemos desde acciones a nivel local, desde sembrar el maíz como una forma de resistir, hasta organizarnos a nivel de local, a nivel regional, a nivel nacional y a nivel internacional. Aquí es donde entra entonces el papel por el que aceptamos de alguna manera asociarnos o aliarnos con el consorcio, que es una organización global conformado también por pueblos indígenas, comunidades locales de diferentes partes del mundo, así como organizaciones, ONGs, que apoyan a estas comunidades, a nosotros mismos. Es una organización que está conformada por, bueno, para funcionar, también es importante mencionar que está conformada por semivoluntarios. En este caso a mí me tocó el papel de coordinar algunas acciones en la región de Mesoamérica. Y en México lo que estamos haciendo es organizar lo que le llamamos red TACS, que es Territorios Autónomos Comunitarios, así es como nosotros es lo que más acercó a lo que nosotros entendimos como TICAS, y estamos trabajando con comunidades de Sonora, de Morelos, de Nayarit y con comunidades de la península de Yucatán. Algo que es muy importante es ¿qué hacemos entonces a este nivel internacional? Principalmente es participar en los foros internacionales donde se ha logrado que tenga visibilidad este tema, donde hemos logrado que, junto con muchísima gente también que está trabajando en el tema, se haya avanzado en la misión principal, que es el apoyo y el reconocimiento de los territorios y áreas conservados por pueblos indígenas y comunidades locales. ¿Qué es la clave acá? Básicamente, cuando decimos apoyo y reconocimiento adecuados, es el reconocimiento de los derechos colectivos, el reconocimiento del territorio así como está. Porque hay un peligro cuando estamos en estos foros. Nuestros gobiernos, lo digo así en plural, pero también lo podemos decir en particular. En México, por ejemplo, existe el peligro de apropiarse de esos avances. ¿De qué manera? Por ejemplo, en el último reporte del Relator Especial de Derechos Humanos y Medio Ambiente, se reconoce incluso este papel en los avances, este papel que tienen los TICA, en los avances en el Convenio de Diversidad Biológica. Se reconoce el papel que tienen los TICAs para lograr las metas de Aichi en el Convenio de Diversidad Biológica. Sin embargo, nuestro gobierno lo toma y dice, sí reconozco los territorios, pero yo los certifico. Es decir, las comunidades en México se conocen como reservas voluntarias. Es decir, tienes que tener como comunidad tu plan de manejo, tu plan de ordenamiento. Al final de cuentas, sí existes, pero solamente si yo te reconozco. Y no es eso lo que estamos peleando. Lo que nosotros estamos luchando es el reconocimiento así como está. Porque no necesitamos un papel que diga que estamos haciendo lo que ya estamos haciendo, sino el reconocimiento tal cual, ¿no? Ese es uno de los peligros. Y también ahí está una de las invitaciones a ustedes, como decía la relatora Vicky, cómo lograr tener más información que permita sustentar lo que nosotros sabemos que ya está. Ustedes han visto los mapas, por ejemplo, de las ANPs que normalmente se ven verdes y alrededor se ven como naranjita, cafecito, que significa que como si no hubiera conservación alrededor, ¿no? Cuando es todo lo contrario, o al menos son esas áreas que están alrededor de las reservas las que permiten realmente el funcionamiento y que ya no sean unas islotas nuestras reservas, nuestras ANPs, nuestras áreas protegidas en México. Eso es básicamente el mensaje. ¿Cómo podemos colaborar para que tengamos entonces más información, más argumentos para demostrar, insisto, de lo que nosotros ya sabemos que tenemos, lo que nosotros ya sabemos que estamos haciendo, junto con toda esta defensa que se está haciendo actualmente del territorio, porque está en peligro? No importa que hayan reservas, eso no es ninguna garantía, y en México ustedes deben saber, aunque están las reservas declaradas, también están las concesiones mineras encima, aunque estén promoviendo este desarrollo del que nosotros decimos que ya no queremos, nos dicen, ok, ya no quieren, entonces hay ecoturismo, pero sobre los proyectos de ecoturismo ponemos las reservas, sobre los proyectos de reserva, sobre las reservas ponemos megaproyectos, y es un no se entiende pues lo que está haciendo estas mismas instituciones que se contradicen todo el tiempo. No sé si tengo más. Okay. Entonces, ¿cuál es la forma en la que nosotros estamos trabajando a nivel local, nacional y regional? Estamos a nivel local, insisto, resistiendo a través de nuestras organizaciones locales. Queremos hacer las redes nacionales y también la red global, que básicamente es unirnos como territorios. Lo que estamos entendiendo cada vez que nos encontramos es que compartimos los mismos problemas y creo que podemos tener el ingenio y la creatividad de encontrar soluciones en conjunto. Es muy difícil, y lo digo de verdad, es muy triste que nuestras luchas en nuestros mismos países a veces es muy difícil coordinarnos. Es muy complicado también hablar de temas de conservación con muchas comunidades que desconfían, y por algo será. Pero también un poco traigo a la memoria en nuestra organización, en el consorcio. Recién hace unas semanas falleció el presidente, Taghi Farbar, un iraní, indígena nómada. Pero él decía algo muy, muy importante que a mí me quedó, que los pueblos indígenas somos los conservacionistas originales. Tal vez nos robaron el término, tal vez se apropiaron del término, pero en realidad somos los que hacemos las cosas en el campo. Y él decía que los pueblos indígenas somos los conservacionistas originales. Gracias.
Gracias, Albert. Our next speaker is Jose Ole Sime from Kenya. Not Jose, Joseph, apologies. Joseph is the executive director of the Manioto Pastoralist Integrated Development Organization, a national indigenous peoples organization for human rights, social, and economic development. He is the chairman of a network in Kenya for pastoralist hunters and gatherers, and a focal point for the African Indigenous Peoples Climate Change Network, as well as various human rights networks in Africa. He's currently an active member of the United Nations Permanent Forum on Indigenous People and the Human Rights Working Group on the Experts on Indigenous Populations and Communities. He is a board member of Land is Life, the Indigenous Peoples Biocultural Climate Change Assessment Initiative, and other institutions. He is also an independent consultant in local and international organizations and has worked as a social researcher with McGill University in Montreal, Canada. Joseph, please.
Yes, good morning, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you, the moderator, for introducing me. And thank you, the organizers of this event. It's a very important event during our time of crisis. Thank you, David Suzuki Foundation in Canada, the team from David Suzuki Foundation, who really make it possible for us as indigenous people to be part and parcel of this important process. I want to begin by acknowledging the owners of the land. I read very little about Mexico, but for sure I know we have indigenous peoples. People who have struggled, continue to struggle, and continue to resist the many dimensions of marginalization and violations of their right. So I want to honor and respect their presence. My presentation will be some very simple question. I've not prepared a big presentation, but simple questions. I'm engaging with scholars, very known, respected scholars. I'm engaging with institutions of higher learning. And I'm engaging with institutions that have been existed since 1989. It's no question in my mind, it's a long period of time for you to have made a contribution either positively or negatively. It's you to reflect as an institution that is as international society for ecology and economics. You are the one to reflect what impact have you created, positively or negatively. Why am I saying this? Everywhere in the world, research and institutions of higher learning have shaped opinion. Any policy formulation, any policy discussion must get the foundation from a very well-known research, either from a scholar or from an institution of higher learning. This policy and legislation, program if you like, has a bearing impact on the life, on the livelihoods of indigenous peoples and the environment. And in most cases, from where I come from, certain decisions have been formulated from a research that in the end has a serious negative impact on the life of the people on the ground. And whenever the life of the people on the ground have been destroyed, even the environment have not been left intact. The environment must equally suffer the same impact as the people on that environment. And this is why this meeting is extremely very important for us to reflect as we think, what about the next years to come? What about the next years ahead of us? Indigenous peoples, no doubt, all over the world have been subjected to a lot of mistreatment. And it began again with the research question. When somebody graduated from Harvard University or the University of Central Mexico, and the person want to do a research in a very rural village in Tanzania called Ngorongoro, the only requirement is for the research question to be approved. And that is a simple requirement. Get the funding. Here is the funding. The research questions have been approved. And therefore, you go to the field. You go to the field and you collect data and you collect statistics and you analyze. And you present and then you defend. But that is a requirement of any learning institution, any institution of higher learning. And that's the entry point of marginalization. Because the people you are researching on and the issues you are documenting has very little say on your research questions and what you are going to write and what you are going to defend. So there's a serious disconnect between what we are doing and the people on the ground. And I think that needs to be changed. It needs to be changed in line with the United Nations Declaration on the Rights of Indigenous Peoples. It needs to change so that you bring indigenous people on the center of your research. So that you research on issues that are fundamental for their own survival. You research on issues and you make observation and recommendation on the issues and how the environment could be protected. based on the research, based on the findings and recommendation, economic models have been proposed. And not only proposed, but also been adapted. And not only not been adapted, but also they have been imposed to the people on the ground. And as you impose those models to the people, you destroyed what has worked for them since immemorial. And at the end of the day, you have no apology, but you subject people to extreme poverty. You have destroyed the environment, because what you have proposed a model that has to be, mining must be carried out. And therefore, multinational cooperation from the developed world go to Africa, go to Asia, go to Latin America, destroy the environment, and that environment is the foundation for cultural connectivity, spiritual connectivity, support, livelihood for those people to survive. But because it has to be based on a particular model, where in that model you concluded the way these natives are using the land is not productive. And therefore we need a productive model. We need a productive model based on a mining of extractive industry. So at the end, people have suffered. And you got your PhD, you are now teaching, and most likely that's the end between you and the community. The day you submitted and you defended your thesis, most likely to end the relationship between you and the community. And that's very different from the way we do things as indigenous peoples. Because in that case, it's you alone. While in our case, it's us. Us means the people, the environment, and the ecosystem. These three are fundamental. These three are integrated. These three, one cannot exist without the other. They are fundamental. They are interconnected. And this is how we have survived all these years, despite the many, many years of difficulties as indigenous peoples. So we need to change the methodology of how do we work with the research. Even when you propose, when you conclude your thesis, people in Oliondo or Ngorongoro has no idea what you wrote, and they may never see it, unfortunately. Maybe there's a good component. Maybe there's some good element of your research, but there's no feedback. You don't have a mechanism. Neither your institution of higher learning has no mechanism to give feedback to those people. Maybe they may pick one or two issues to push forward on their own. And I think to me, getting into this forum, I think we are suffered as indigenous people, and as coming from Africa, where we have nomadic society pastoralists. You all recall an article that was published around, most likely in the New York Times, around the 60s, the tragedy of the commons. We become victims of that publication. And we're still struggling on that. Because what research does, it shapes public opinion. Even when maybe it's not accurate, but it shapes public opinion. And public opinion today, with the latest technology, the media, you carry the day. Because you influence the public opinion. And you have influenced public opinion on the wrong direction, not on the right one. Unfortunately, in most cases, indigenous people have no political voice, has no control of the media, has no control of the market forces, and therefore become the victims of what the research has influenced the public opinion. So it's not just about the policy, either the UN level or the country level, but even the general public opinion is fundamental. And I think for me, as I see future relationship, future engagement between the International Society for Ecology and Economics, I think we need to start thinking what are the best model even of doing research so that you empower the community rather than to disempower them. My second point is basically to see us indigenous peoples. I mentioned earlier models that are being proposed, and most of those models are coming from economics and are coming from institutions of higher learning. What is wrong? What is so difficult for our economics, indigenous people economics, to be adapted as a model? What is wrong with that? Remember when Kenya was going through a financial crisis, just like many other countries, we never realized that Kenya was going through a financial crisis. Our economy is based on livestock, doesn't base on $1 a day. Because even my people have never seen a dollar. When you impose them to measure their wealth based on a dollar, they don't know what a dollar is all about, because they never seen it. You tell them, how do they measure wealth? They tell you, one, the number of livestock, the land available and a healthy environment, and the number of children you have. That's how wealth is measured. Completely different from the model which is being imposed on people. What's wrong for the society, for the scholars, to document what is working in indigenous people territories? I believe research is to document new knowledge. And I think time has come for us to realize there is existing knowledge among indigenous peoples. There are existing economical model which is friendly to the people, which is friendly to the environment, which is a better future for us, all of us. If you destroy what I have, we suffer the same. And I think that's what is happening at the moment. I conclude by saying this. Indigenous peoples, the adoption of the Paris Agreement to deal with the issue of climate change has proposed a number of initiatives. I wish if research through institution of where you come from, a partnership to be developed between indigenous peoples and these institutions or academia to look into what they call the green transformation. What does it mean? What is it? To me, coming from Kenya, I get scared. When this discussion started, I see as another way for land grabbing. And if you go to the internet and check what they called Lake Turkana wind power, you realize what I'm talking about. So we need a partnership, a genuine partnership based on trust, based on ethic, based on the United Nations Declaration on the Rights of Indigenous Peoples. So that rights of the people, rights of the environment become the center of whatever we are going to develop. So that you hear me, despite our indigenous peoples, many have not gone to Harvard University, or have not gone to the Central Mexico University. The fact remains, they're not stupid. They're very knowledgeable. And they can contribute, they can give solution to the crisis that we are facing today. What we need to accommodate is to take them as genuine partners, to build a genuine and a last partnership and a collaboration. I conclude by asking this question. What mechanism are you going to use as a society to monitor both the performance and the recommendation you are going to give in this conference to see what changes has occurred in the next 5 years? So from this meeting to the next 5 years, what likely are we going to see in indigenous people territories? I wish you the best, and I wish this meeting to achieve the best goal that I was set to achieve. Thank you.
neglected to mention he's a member of the Maasai community in Kenya. Our next speaker is Tamara Goddard. Tamara is Canadian. She has an extraordinary understanding of nation building, Aboriginal business, First Nations governance, culture, and history. I said she was Canadian. I should have probably said she's from the Tsotsitaal Nation, and it's from northeastern British Columbia in Canada. She works on identifying and creating solutions to build healthy Indigenous economies in our province. She recently completed an executive master's of business administration at Simon Fraser University, specializing in First Nations business and leadership. Her primary focus is on the study of traditional Indigenous ideologies and how these ideologies can be effectively asserted in the current Western systems in a complementary fashion. Over the last 15 years, Tamara has developed and facilitated entrepreneurship programs in over 40 British Columbia communities, First Nations communities. Additionally, she has worked with multiple First Nations and Aboriginal organizations toward developing and implementing partnerships, strategies, and corporate development partnerships that will benefit their nations. She's the primary designer of the For the People, For the Future lens, which guides generational planning for Indigenous communities. Tamara continues to develop and implement this model with collaborators David Fierro and Chief Gibby Jacob of the Squamish Nation in British Columbia. Tamara, please.
Hello. I'd like to thank the David Suzuki Foundation for inviting us to attend here today. I travel around British Columbia every single week, but I don't often leave Canada. In fact, I hardly ever leave Canada. There are 230 First Nations in British Columbia, Canada. There are over 600 in Canada together. So just in the province that I work in, there are 230. What's unique about British Columbia is that these 230 nations have never ceded their territory. In the rest of Canada, we work with something called treaties. So regardless of how they were signed, we still have a lot of rights in Canada. What I'm hoping to talk to you today about, and what I'm hoping to do is cause you to be a bit uncomfortable in my presentation to you today. When I work with First Nations, and then I work with government, and then I work with business, there is a chasm, a cultural clash that exists that is so readily apparent that it's hard to even find the topic to begin a discussion. And this topic for me began when I was a small child. When I was a small child, I was not raised by my mother, because it's standard practice in Canada through residential school systems, through day scholar school systems, and through what's called the 60 scoop, that we didn't get to grow up in our communities. In my particular case, I was raised by a good Canadian family, Norwegian and British. What was unique about that situation was I come from a people that are dreamers. And as a young child, I dreamed. And in my dreams, I learned about natural law. In my dreams, I learned about the history of my ancestors. In fact, what I learned in my dreams was so profound and so important that I grew up thinking the entire world around me was crazy. I thought the school systems were nuts. I thought these teachers were teaching me things that had no bearing. I watched as they bowled over my backyard, which was Burns Bog, which was a huge natural resource. And I spent most of my time sitting in that natural resource. And I wrote. I wrote everything I learned in my dreams on paper, and I believed them. I understood innately things that I had no way of knowing. I understood myths that I had no way of knowing. And I expressed these artistically. When I grew older, when I was 5 years old, my mother embarked on a 12-year journey to find me. And she had enough of a network around British Columbia, and she was working with First Nations and working in the political realm. And with all of her connections, in 12 years, she was able to find me. And at that time, she took me back home, and she introduced me back to my family, and she took me all over British Columbia and introduced me to the rich world of nations. And that's when I learned that everything I had dreamed was real. It was our history. It was our folklore. It was our myths. It was our stories, and it was natural law. My confusion caused me to be a very curious person, though. And so now I wanted to look at the systems that were oppressing our peoples, and I wanted to affect change in those systems. And so I first tried to do that through art, and I started studying physics, and I started studying the languages of light and the languages of music, and hoping that I could impact people, a change within their hearts, whereby their minds would open and they would understand that we're all the same, that we're all one, that this earth is here to support and protect us, that you never move forward alone, and that this economic system and this way of teaching us how to think because somebody else verifies that I am correct, instead of our innate ability to critically think and look around and have a relationship with our environment where it teaches us how to behave with it in order to survive on this beautiful planet. So I did this for a while, just with art and graphics, and I started communicating for many nations. It was at that point that the nations of BC started inviting me to help them communicate their culture, Aboriginal tourism, Indigenous artists. Why aren't we entering the economy? Why can't we participate in the economy? What's going on with the environment? Why is it that we live in a world that wants to segregate and partition everything into these categories that simply don't exist if you're going to have a healthy generational future? In fact, it's the very ability to critically think, and is the very ability to have a relationship not just with each other as human beings, but with the earth and with the ecosystem and with the animals and with the plants in order to survive. And so I move that. Relationships are our bottom line, not the dollar. And so with that, I began to study economics with Indigenous peoples, and then I went back to university. I did about 15 years of intense research with about 10 research assistants across Canada and across BC. And the subject matters were social, so sociodemographics, social wellness, cultural wellness, culture in the workplace, wellness in the workplace. And it was always a situation of applying for money, and the money had strings attached, and we would try and implement these programs, and we would try and bring back culture. And then we would submit to the government. And at one point, my reports were submitted to 14 levels of government to ask for change. 14 levels over 10 years. First Nations governments, Canadian governments, BC governments, municipal governments. They were big reports. And they would take maybe one recommendation. And I'm sitting here as a holistic person going, but all the recommendations need to fit together in order for this change to happen. And we can't look at this as a quarterly, how many people did you educate? And how will they participate in our economy now? We weren't even asking the right questions. So I went back to school again. I started studying business because the government wasn't going to pay for us. So now what I do understand is that it was the corporations working with the governments that was causing our funding and the political system to keep changing and shifting and moving and changing and shifting. And nothing was happening. And what I was witnessing is that we were losing another generation. We were losing another generation of peoples that would grow up to keep our cultures alive and keep our lands safe. And what will happen if we lose that generation and the poverty in our communities and the water in our communities and the rates of sickness in our communities? So I felt very pressured to move fast. I worked with several different First Nations to develop corporate partnership models. And the corporate partnership models initially started with just simply a for the people model. It's F-O-U-R, for the people, because we tended to forget about the environment and our people at the negotiation table at the highest levels with the government. And I was fortunate enough to sit at those negotiation tables and prep the negotiators and chiefs to negotiate the best outcome. And because I'm a researcher, I was able to measure all these outcomes. for the people means that every single negotiation that the lawyers and the top tables go to included plans to redo procurement policies for all of our traditional territories to allow our peoples to have access to contracts that we cared about. It provided opportunities for entrepreneurs to get the proper training and understand how to successfully enter the supply chain in order to build a successful community. It involved not just training so that we could work on the ship that they were building or the LNG plant they were building, but it provided career track training, allowing people to figure out where they wanted to go and that it wasn't good enough to have our people digging your ditch just for 2 years or 3 months or 5 years. No, we wanted to have career tracks, and that needed to mean, that meant that corporations needed to change. It meant that cities needed to change. We successfully implemented that model with the Squamish First Nation, along with several partnerships and billions of dollars of industry there. I tried to submit this model to my university, and I called it a wealth-sharing model. And they didn't understand my wealth-sharing model in a business class. So I further developed the model because now we had people at the table of our negotiations, but what I really realized is the environment wasn't there. Where are we going to work if the environment isn't there? Where do our medicines come from, and how do we feed ourselves, and how do we fix the land? So I added the second force, and the second force is power security, water security, housing security, and land security. We need to have these things. And now we have 8 tiers that are capable of chiefs and councils and governments and corporations as a lens. This lens is used in law to set partnership agreements, accommodations agreements. It's used in business partnerships to perform due diligence of the internal workings of corporations to ensure they are capable of protecting the environment with us as partners and to grow our people economically. This is a very fine system that comes with many, many different moving parts, and we have templated and continue to template them now, and we are now bringing law. Actually, we've already had teams of lawyers work with us on this, but we are now bringing with our company, our own legal team, to start developing these into legal agreements. So the legal agreements happen not just within the community. Now what we have is a community that can say, this is what we want to do. And part of our business model is to set up ecological restoration companies. And our ecological restoration companies actually go back out onto the land and start not just recovering or remediating, but we do things like pre-disturbance inventories. We create our own soils now. So we've got, in the last 6 months, we've got greenhouses growing our own traditional plants so that when we replace our plants, it's our own traditional plants. David is fighting to stop pesticide spray in all of British Columbia. We have soils that are being created to mimic the own soil, our own soils that used to be on our lands, coming back to our lands. And we have our peoples walking out to our lands, re-understanding and teaching biologists and scientists as they come into our territory what it means to take care of our lands, why it's important, and what can be recovered. So moving forward, I hope I can leave you with a couple questions. In my work, I have worked with over 300 First Nations in Canada, thousands of First Nations peoples, elders, artists, cultural keepers, hunters, gatherers, professionals, negotiators. And in every point and every research paper that I have ever done, the question I asked was never correct. Because there was really nothing about shifting your perspective to one of a holistic view where everything is operating the same. We are not the only peoples with rights. We do not own this land. The earth and what is provided for us and the luxuries it's provided for us is just as much of a being as we are. And if we want to survive multiple generations, we are going to have to acknowledge that there was an ecosystem that caused us to be these great nations of today. And we need to come back to these ecosystems and understand them fully. And I hope that our indigenous people can be acknowledged for their thousands of years of experience in caretaking each other and the lands and the animals. Thank you for listening today.
Medicine healer and a human rights activist. She was chosen as a representative indigenous spokeswoman by the National Indigenous Congress for the 2018 general election, for which she hoped to run as an independent candidate for the presidency of Mexico. On May 28, 2017, a Congress was held in San Cristobal de las Casas, where Mary Choi was designated as the representative indigenous spokeswoman by 840 delegates from 60 indigenous communities in Mexico. The Congress also resolved to choose her as the indigenous representative to run in the 2018 general election, which I understand did not happen, unfortunately. The media did, however, report that she was the first indigenous woman to run for the presidency of Mexico. We are very pleased that she made it here today. It sounds like it was a long and challenging journey, but we would like to invite you up, and we've given all of the speakers 15 minutes to speak to the audience, and then we will return to question and answer period.
Buenos días o tardes. Una disculpa, llegamos corriendo tarde, pero aquí estamos. Pues sobre el tema que están tratando aquí, platicando, que ya varios comentaron, hermanos que están aquí en la mesa, decirles que justamente los pueblos indígenas de México, agrupados en el Congreso Nacional Indígena, los que hemos caminado por más de 20 años juntos, hemos visto que nuestras comunidades pues, que nuestras comunidades las quieren desaparecer, las quieren acabar imponiéndoles programas, empresas, los megaproyectos que trae el capitalismo, y que no le importa si hay habitantes, si tiene sus árboles, si tiene sus aguas, no le importa si destruye eso, con tal de tener un dinero. Entonces, los pueblos que hemos analizado este caminar por más de 20 años, estamos viendo con tristeza cómo el capitalismo no le importa destruir esos territorios, acabar esas aguas, acabar esos bosques, destruir comunidades enteras, quitándolas de donde están, mandándolas a otros lugares. Y por eso los pueblos que hemos caminado decidimos participar en esta contienda 2018 con ese fin, de que los pueblos hablaran y mostraran qué cosas no están de acuerdo, qué está pasando ahora con todos los megaproyectos que están imponiendo en estos territorios indígenas. Toda esa destrucción que están llevando a nuestros pueblos, disfrazada de desarrollo. Por eso se hizo esta propuesta y lo dijimos claro, no queremos estar allá en una silla, presidencial. Queremos que escuchen que tenemos problemas en nuestros pueblos y que estos están desapareciendo. Los están acabando con las minas, con las hidroeléctricas, con las eólicas, con los megaproyectos que están instalando en nuestros pueblos. Entonces, pues nosotros vemos ese peligro. Los pueblos que hemos caminado y que hemos luchado por mantener nuestros territorios íntegros. Y por eso han muerto varios hermanos. Varios los han desaparecido. Varios están encarcelados. Otros que acaban de desaparecer y que no sabemos dónde están. Porque no estamos de acuerdo, pues, que nuestros territorios sean destruidos de esa manera, con los grandes proyectos que trae el capitalismo y que no le importa que venga a dañar esas tierras, que son tierras sagradas para nuestras comunidades. Que la tierra en nuestros pueblos es una madre y la madre está sufriendo. Y por eso nosotros los pueblos decidimos participar y decirles a todos aquí en México, pueblos indígenas y no indígenas, que es necesario juntarnos entre todos, porque está en peligro nuestro planeta. No es solamente los pueblos indígenas, porque se está modificando el ciclo del agua. Allá en la región donde yo vivo, hay unas empresas que lo que hacen es detener el agua. Cuando vemos que se pone la nube grande y que ya va a llover, de pronto desaparece y ya no llueve. Entonces, los que siembran el maíz para la tortilla, pues dicen, ya no vamos a sembrar porque ya no cae el agua como caía. Pero, ¿qué está pasando con estos que vienen e imponen estas empresas? Pues no quieren perder ellos y no les importa si están modificando una alimentación de esa comunidad donde están agarrando esas tierras. Entonces, nosotros lo que vemos es que hay un acuerdo por parte del gobierno con estos empresarios de dejarles puerta libre y que vengan e impongan esos megaproyectos que lo único que nos están trayendo es modificar nuestra alimentación, dejar de sembrar la tierra, dejar de cultivar eso que por años es lo que nos da vida en nuestras comunidades. Entonces, por eso consideramos que todo este sistema capitalista que no le importa si destruye, si modifica, si desaparece una comunidad entera, no le importa porque lo que le importa es el dinero, nada más. Entonces, pues los pueblos que hemos caminado, nosotros vamos peleando no solamente porque se conserve nuestro territorio, sino que se respete nuestra organización, la organización que es por años, pues, que se tiene. Y que no es porque un gobierno no la da, sino que es algo que ha estado y ha existido con la vida de las comunidades. En las comunidades los cargos no son pagados, son nombrados en una asamblea para cuidar a la comunidad, cuidar sus tierras, cuidar sus aguas, cuidar sus bosques. Y si este que lo ponen al frente no cumple, entonces lo quitan y ponen a otro que sí cuide, pues. Entonces, es algo colectivo. Y por eso cuando se decide lanzar esta propuesta, es porque estamos pensando que es necesario que se escuche y se vea que esto que está trayendo el capitalismo nos va a afectar a todos. Entonces, los pueblos pensamos que si no damos la lucha junto, pueblos indígenas y hermanos que están también en la ciudad luchando, si no se da una lucha conjunta, el capitalismo nos va a destruir y nos va a acabar, y lo estamos viendo con el calentamiento global, con el agua que ya no es pareja, con los ríos que están contaminando y que no solamente afecta a una comunidad, sino que va a afectar también a la ciudad. Con esa modificación de alimentos que se están generando y que están trayendo muchísimas enfermedades. Yo soy médico tradicional y veo con tristeza cada vez enfermedades más difíciles de curar, enfermedades raras, y todas son por los invernaderos, por los que van al campo a trabajar, se los llevan y se mueren a los 10 años, ya tienen un cáncer producto de que estuvo trabajando en un invernadero. Y se está agravando, y se está complicando, y todo es por eso, pues, todo este desarrollo que está trayendo el capitalismo y que no le importan, nosotros lo vemos pues así, no le importan los habitantes, le importa tener dinero, sacar provecho. ¿A costa de qué? Pues hasta del desplazamiento pues de comunidades. Entonces, como ven, nuestra lucha es fuerte, la vamos a seguir llevando a cabo. Como dijimos, no era llegar a la presidencia, sino dar a conocer la gran problemática que se tiene en nuestros pueblos, en nuestros barrios, colonias, en la ciudad, y lo que se está creando en las escuelas. Los muchachos, una educación que nada más tienen que obedecer. Y no, pues, nosotros vemos que tenemos que tomar las riendas de nosotros mismos si queremos seguir viviendo. Por eso decíamos, la lucha es por la vida. Y queremos vida para todos. Y vamos a luchar y la vamos a seguir construyendo. Y por eso hemos dicho, no solamente los pueblos indígenas, sino todos los que consideramos que es necesario cuidar las aguas, cuidar los bosques, cuidar la tierra, cuidar la forma organizativa, colectiva. Entonces, pues hay mucho, mucho trabajo, y creo que no solamente es para México, sino que es de todo el planeta, que tenemos que ir conjuntando lazos, pensando cómo le vamos a hacer para que los que vienen atrás de nosotros les dejemos algo bueno, porque si no se lo van a acabar, los que quieren solamente dinero se lo van a acabar, y entonces nuestros hijos o los hijos de nuestros hijos, ¿en qué van a vivir, qué van a comer? Entonces, pues hay una grande tarea. Nosotros los pueblos indígenas consideramos que nuestra lucha la vamos a continuar, que no fue electoral. Es una lucha organizativa y que nos va a llevar años, y que tal vez los que ahorita estamos no vamos a estar, pero van a continuar los que vienen atrás. Entonces, pues es lo que les puedo decir y dejar. Ay, disculpan si yo estoy hablando algo que no es, pero bueno, es lo que estamos llevando a cabo en el Congreso Nacional Indígena, los pueblos que hemos caminado por más de 20 años. Gracias.
Perdón. Yo tengo una pregunta para Marichuy. Marichuy. Tengo una pregunta. La lucha de que tú estás hablando, ¿tienes algunas sugerencias de cómo nosotros aquí, mayormente fincados en la academia, podremos o deberíamos repensar la forma en que trabajamos nosotros para fortalecer, para apoyar, para acompañarles en esta lucha que tú dices que vas a seguir, que van a seguir?
Como nosotros somos un, sí es el Congreso Nacional Indígena, pero hay un Consejo Indígena de Gobierno que es el que participó en este proceso electoral 2018 y que son alrededor de 150 concejales. Son representantes de pueblos indígenas de todo México. Este consejo es la forma de gobierno que se pretende, pues, establecer en el territorio de los pueblos indígenas. Y como fuimos diciendo en el caminar, es que cada quien, si son estudiantes, si son mujeres, si son obreros, si son… los estábamos invitando a que teníamos que buscar una forma de poder enlazar el trabajo que se lleva o que estamos llevando. Es una invitación a que, si en este trabajo que estamos llevando cada quien vamos luchando por la vida, entonces se va a buscar forma. No es que nosotros les digamos cómo le tienen que hacer, sino que cada quien tiene que buscarle de tal forma que se apoye este caminar, pues, de los pueblos, ¿verdad?
We're not certain whether our last panelist, Maria Choi Patricio, will make it or not. We'll keep going as long as they give us time, and if she appears, we will gladly bring her up to the stage. But our last panelist who is in attendance at the moment is David Fierro. David's traditional name, Haha Shmanucht, is an elder of the Okanagan Nation. With more than 20 years of experience and a multidisciplinary education, David specializes in biological systems from a First Nations perspective. He works with corporations, industry, and First Nations to develop and implement economical and elegant solutions in regard to any kind of development taking place on First Nations traditional territories. He has worked in the role of environmental assessment, economic solutions, and negotiations for entities such as the Squamish Nation, the Saulteaux Nation, and the BC First Nations Forestry Council. In these roles, he reviews applications for development for everything from residential and commercial to industrial operations. He deciphers environmental assessments for First Nations and works to protect the traditional values of those nations in any agreements that are made. David.
Thank you. You'll have to forgive me, I'm a little bit of a low talker. I thank the David Suzuki Foundation and Jay and Michelle for the invitation to come here and speak to you today on this traditional territory. It's very difficult to follow these people on this panel, but I will give you my meager portion for you to mull over. And it'll be broken into small pieces. I think the largest thing that I have to contribute is that I have been burdened with the task of trying to bridge the language barrier between the academics and the indigenous peoples. There's this large gap, And I've had to go into a multidisciplinary approach in order to try and find the language to describe it to you or to paint a picture for you. Now, I wish to speak plainly today because I have the expectation that sooner or later, some of the elders that I work with will be watching this tape or this transmission, and they will have the expectation that they're able to understand as well, to make sure that I'm offering you the proper message. And if I fumble a few things for them on their behalf, I would ask for their forgiveness and I ask for your patience. Let's see. I think the first thing to go over is the term economics. From an indigenous or an original people's point of view, economics, the economy, cannot just be measured in wealth, but in waste. With the large industry that we have on a global scale, there is a tremendous amount of waste. The cream is taken, but all of the other materials are left in very vast amounts. So if I start going through different industries such as mining, tailings ponds are man-made, they're built to fail. And we've had one that happened about 4 years ago called the Mount Polly spill. Now, just releasing that much dirt and water would have a tremendous impact, but the fact is it is a resource that's only after one or two particular metals. The rest of the metals were released in a tremendous amount, which if I'm thirsty and someone straps me to the bottom of a pool, I'm going to get too much of a good thing. So the environment requires minuscule amounts of what was released all at once, because that mountain was ground down to its roots within 2 decades, and then it was all released at the same time. So the impact on an environmental scale is, it can't be quantified, it can't be put into a monetary amount. Within a week, I was standing on the tailings that were going into Quesnel Lake, which was a pristine lake, and all of the people up to Fraser were dependent on the salmon that came through that territory. I was sitting in on the meetings where representatives of the company and the government and the health ministry were in attendance trying to convey what had happened, and all of the people were in shock. For them, seeing that happen to their traditional territory would be like being informed that their entire family had been wiped out in a car accident. Their very essence is tied to the land. Their language, the reason that there's 230 different nations is there's 230 different locations that have a very special, very primal value. All the plants are different, the dirt is different, the air is different. The language is based on the land that they're standing on. Their ancestors are in that land. So when that land is disturbed, it's taken as an offense. Quite often, I've had to repatriate remains from where they've been excavated for someone to put in a new fence post. Now, unbeknownst to that person, they didn't realize that that would be a very important find, but leaving it on the side of the street for the police to come by and pick it up, that's a very disturbing and emotional impact. The peoples of our land go back over 10,000 years. So when it comes to making an economic model that works, an environmental system that works, they've already mastered it. But their ability to convey that information to someone that is looking at a very small particle of a very complex whole is extremely difficult. It takes years of immersion into the territory, into the lands, and being able to speak with the elders to grasp the understanding of how it all interconnects. And then extends around the entire globe. Everything is connected. So when we talk about economy, we're talking about a lack of waste, making the most of the resources that you are going to be extracting and replacing with something else of equal value. Now, to a global economist, what is of equal value may not be entertained. For us, it may just be something that is going to start to regenerate the forest that's been cut. Speaking on forestry, a small story for the continuity that indigenous peoples are looking at their environment. a grandmother will come up and she will take some of the bark from a cedar tree, not enough to kill the tree. And she will use it to make textiles, she will weave, she will make clothing out of it, she will make artwork, she will use it for binding. The next generation comes to that same tree and peels off a little bit more bark on each side. And they do the same thing. And the next generation comes back to the same tree and chops out a spot of the bare wood and uses it to make tools or bowls because now that tree has been hardened in that particular area. So there's a purpose to the continuity of going back to the same tree. But once that tree is cut, that ability is gone. That skill, that culture, that language is missing as well. It really doesn't matter what industry we apply this model to. From an indigenous point of view, everything is interconnected. And if the industry and the economy is broken into sections without reflecting on how it's affecting the whole, we all lose. So I've walked most of the territory in BC. I've interfaced with many, many different nations and spoken with the elders, but more importantly, I sat there and I listened to the stories. They have to take their time. There's a lot of information that they want to give you if they can speak about it. Tamara was talking about the residential school system. I'm sure that all of you are aware that there were atrocities that have been committed in every country where there are original peoples. They're taken from their land, they're taken from their family, they're taken from their culture, their language, their spirituality. When they return to their community, quite often they're shunned because they no longer fit. They don't have the capacity here to be able to reintegrate into the community. And they also don't have the capacity on the exterior to fit into a new economic regime, whoever happens to be occupying the territory. They are in a limbo. Later on, 20, 30, 40 years, they still can't speak about their culture or their language or whatever it is that they learned as a child because they have PTSD. And I've been in ceremony, broad daylight, one particular word, a particular sound, and you have someone in their 60s or 70s going and hyperventilating and hugging themselves and not being able to function. That is the loss of the oral tradition of the nations in North America. Nothing was written, it was all story told. And if it wasn't story told, it was practiced. So as academics, you can't learn all the information that is essential in the classroom. It can't be learned in an office, can't be learned in a boardroom, it can't be learned here. You have to get some dirt under your fingernails and go find the original peoples of the territory and allow them to tell you the stories in the order that they want, in the time that they want. You need to develop a relationship so that they can trust you and feel safe with you. Quite often, in order to get your dissertation or your papers, pointed questions are asked. But it's a model that's meant to fail because you don't have the context. And I've talked with PhDs, and I've talked with professors, and I've talked with the presidents of corporations. And when you find the information that they have mastery of, and you plug it into the whole, they light up. They become a human being again because their information now has value. And if they have made certain assumptions walking in, because we know that the victors write history, we're able to dissolve that and show that it's not an us against them kind of mentality. We want to teach. We want to be a part of what's happening. But we want it done responsibly because we don't think about the first quarter, the second quarter, the third quarter. Our elders normally lived 120 years. Their stories would go back 10, 15, 30 generations. So that continuity, that the expectation that was from them to the young ones was that continuity should be expanded. Don't try to control the environment so much as live within the environment and learn to think critically so that you can adapt to the environment. If you try to go to a monoculture, it fails. If you try to use a reductionist model for economy, it fails because it allows for too much waste and there isn't enough to replenish, there isn't enough time. So now I see everyone at this crux, this point in time where indigenous knowledge is more than just an aside, something to be placed on a piece of paper and perhaps taken a look at and then pushed off. It is essential that that knowledge be brought to bear now, because the industrial model, the reductionist model, is a self-terminating model. We can see it in the environment everywhere that we go. In order to remove the cream, we have degraded the system to the point where it is no longer able to repair itself. And now it needs our help. But the people that have that knowledge are sitting here waiting to be given a proper seat at the table so that we can inform you, so that the proper decisions are made in a timely manner. I really don't know what else to say. I really appreciate the fact that you're all here gathered, trying to get some information, perhaps some inspiration from the people that are here about how to change your thinking a little bit in order to integrate indigenous knowledge. And the biggest piece of information that I can give you on that is get out to the communities and spend some time. Don't spend a weekend. Spend some time. Go back repeatedly, go back often until you've built up a rapport and a relationship, and let them teach you. There's so much to learn. It's so rich. And it'll make all of your work better. Ours too. Thank you.
Thank you, David. As a moderator, I would just like to thank all of you. I did not have to cut off a single person. That was amazing. Thank you. No, it's been incredible working with this group of people. They have so much to share. We really, really all wanted to have an opportunity for this group to ask some questions.
De campesinos en montaña costera, que es una zona que está muy degradada y que está además rodeada parcialmente por distintas comunidades indígenas que han sido reducidas en sus territorios a lo mínimo posible. Y lo que he visto, sin trabajar tan directamente con ellos, es que básicamente, bueno, Chile muchos quizás lo conocen por ser una figura o un ícono de la implementación de un modelo neoliberal de manera violenta y muy rápida. Hoy en día, después de que, bueno, ocurren las primeras elecciones en 1990, el Estado entiende muy bien que debe, de alguna manera, tranquilizar, convencer o tratar de manipular, yo creo, a las comunidades indígenas para, en el fondo, que no hagan demandas territoriales muy fuertes. Y eso ha pasado durante los últimos 20 años y hoy en día la región de la Araucanía en particular es una región que en algunas partes sí tiene demandas más por autonomía territorial, pero en otras zonas la cantidad de dinero que está invirtiendo el Estado para que estas personas tengan su proyecto de mermeladas, su ecoturismo, su etcétera, va erosionando y va viendo cómo al final termina dividiendo. Y uno dice, no, esta persona es un líder indígena y qué sé yo. Pero realmente estas personas, el gobierno las identifica, les entrega mucho financiamiento y finalmente no son realmente líderes de su comunidad. Y es una forma en la que opera, en la que el Estado desactiva muy inteligentemente a estas comunidades. Y eso, volviéndolo al tema más medioambiental, tiene consecuencias tremendas, porque existe un discurso, no, nosotros cuidamos, nosotros estamos muy preocupados, pero realmente en la práctica eso ya se ha olvidado o prácticamente no existe, o está muy, muy incipiente. No quiero decir que no existe, porque yo creo que tiene que existir en algún lado. Entonces la pregunta es cómo o desde dónde uno empieza como a buscar, a recordar o a revivir estos valores, historias, conocimientos que estaban ahí anteriormente, pero que han sido por esta estrategia, están cada vez más escondidos.
Tamara, the question around how to start fostering the values of self-assertion and taking, And if any of the other speakers want to address as well.
Pues gracias.
In getting people to start. You mentioned implementation. So my mother became a professor of indigenous law. And her work took our stories, our traditional stories, and she interpreted them to be recognized by the Canadian law system. And so that actually sparked about 20 years of winning streaks in the courts of Canada. So that was one thing, law. And also understanding that those tradition, if you have traditional stories in traditional language, you had your own common law. That common law can be interpreted and it can be understood in the context of country you live in. So that's one important step. But the other important step, and this is the area that we work in, is that corporations are very powerful. And they're the ones meeting with your government and determining our futures. So what I tend to do is take the threat of law into corporate negotiations. Now, because they can't speak with me, and because I know, because I guess, for lack of a better word, I'm a business negotiator, economist type, very good with numbers. And so I can come up with economic models for corporations and communities to work together where it's plus, plus, plus. It's good for everybody, including their project. But that needs to be done in collaboration with the community, and that is the difficult part. You need to raise money. You need to be an expert proposal writer. You need to have enough monies to make sure you're never walking alone. You have to walk with community, and you have to listen. And then you have to interpret into the corporate realm, and you have to interpret into the government realm, maybe less important in the corporate. So proposal writing. Understand your traditions, interpret that into law, and then find that lens. What is important? Because if you're sitting at a negotiation table with a corporation, the lens that we use, that is the four pillars, it's actually eight pillars. It's the land, it's the earth, and it's the people. Without that lens, I can't discuss a topic and come up with an agreement that ensures that our water is protected, that our housing is secure, that our lands are protected, and that we have an ongoing source of power, that we preferably have ownership, because the power is coming from our water, or it's coming from our resources as well. So come up with a lens, simplify it. When you're in a negotiation with a corporation, you need to have a piece of all of this in order to generationally plan. What we're trying to do as Indigenous communities, and hopefully with the rest of the world, is look backwards, understand who we were. We have been here for tens of thousands of years, and I know we fully intend on being here for tens of thousands of years more. We need to have communities and an environment that will withstand all of the economic turmoil and climate change turmoil coming our way. So it's actual implementation is highly detailed. Get a team, write proposals, and really start putting these down into templates, policies, develop a lens to simplify the language so that your agreements can be clear and measured. Thank you.